Hi everyone, so today we're going to look at a game which was played last night between Magnus Carlsen and Hikaru Nakamura. It was the finals of Magnus Carlsen Chess Tour Day 7, the final day, and it is Game 3 we are talking about. So as we all know, there is no doubt about Hikaru was at the top of his form during this tournament, putting the world champion under tremendous pressure till Day 6, also on Day 7. Guys, I mean, it takes a lot to do that. However, it is day 7. In game 1, Magnus won against Hikaru. In game 2, Nakamura managed to draw against Magnus. And now it is game 3. So Hikaru is playing with the white pieces, Magnus with the black pieces. And Hikaru started with the anti-Berlin system, but suddenly went super aggressive and went all out to just checkmate the black's king. So without further delay, let's see what happened in the game. The game was obviously very exciting. And here Hikaru begins the game with e4 and Magnus replies with e5, the king's pawn opening. The game continues with knight f3 attacking this pawn, knight c6 defending it, and bishop b5, the royal op is on the board. So we are not going into details about the opening. However, we have covered many games with the royal op opening where we discussed some of the main ideas of the opening. And in case you want to follow the games, you can find the link of the playlist that is given on the I button. However, here Magnus goes for knight f6, going for the Berlin defense, and d3 by white, the anti-Berlin system. Black here goes for bishop c5, developing the bishop, making a room for the king to castle, also putting pressure on the f2 pawn. So the game continues with bishop into c6, d into c6, and knight b d2 by white. The idea is obviously this knight can jump on c4 developing, also can come on f1 and g3, which is very common in Royal Op's opening. And this knight is also coming on the g4 square. However, that is not much of a problem. Suppose black here goes for knight g4, then white can simply castle. Then bishop into f2 check, rook into f2, and knight into f2, king into f2. The point is that the material point is equal, right? It's a bishop and a knight for a rook and a pawn. But the point is that there is a difference in number of pieces. Black is losing two pieces, whereas white is losing one piece. And that is actually a slight disadvantage for black. So instead of going for knight g4, black here simply goes for castles and h3 by white, preventing the idea of knight g4 here. Carlsen here goes for knight d7. The idea is that after rook e8, this knight is coming on f8, g6, and then on f4. Well, here the f4 is a little bit weak for white. Obviously, white can play g3, but that will make the king side very weak, and not very weak, slightly weak. So there is a little bit weakness that Magnus is trying to take advantage of. So let's see what happens in the game here. White goes for knight c4 now, developing the knight, also preparing to develop the bishop here. a5, now trying to create an attack on the queen side. This pawn is coming on a4. However, here white can go for castle, also maybe developing the bishop, queen e2. There are so many possibilities, but white here goes for g4, creating an attack on the king side, and now the game is becoming very, very exciting and aggressive. The idea is that white is planning for rook g1, pushing h4, g5, h5, and h6, and creating an attack on the king side, and the game is becoming very exciting. Well, black will try to attack on the king side, because there is a saying, I hope you have heard of it, that an attack on the flank can be met with an attack in the center. So that is the basic principle of aggressive chess. However, here black goes for rook e8. Black is sticking with the plan of knight f8 now. Rook g1 a4 now, preparing to create an attack on the queen side. Knight e3 by white. Now this knight is ready to jump on f5 now, and that will be very much helpful for white when he will start creating the start attacking the king side. So this knight gonna be very much powerful and a little bit annoying for black. So here black decides to capture the knight, bishop into e3, bishop into e3, and then knight f8 as we have discussed earlier. So here white goes for h4. The idea is obviously g5 and h5 here. Queen d6 now, activating the queen, preparing to bring it on the queen side. Queen d2 now. White is probably going for a long side castle, at least preparing for a long side castle, and also creating a battery over the c1 h6 diagonal. c5 by black, and h5 going for a kingside attack. And the game has been converted into a race, who can catch his opponent faster. So however, black goes for b5, creating the attack, and knight h4 with the idea of bringing the knight on f5 and weakening the g7 square, because after h6 there will be a lot of pressure on the g7 square. So however, now this knight is coming on f5, attacking the queen. So first queen c6, defending the attack here, and finally knight f5. C4 by black, obviously going all in the queen side, and white here goes for queen b4. The idea is knight e7. Okay, let me make the arrows. Knight e7, check with a fork on giving a threat to capturing the queen. And after rook captures, queen captures, and black will be down a rook. So that is the basic threat here. And black here goes for a very good move, which is a3. The idea is that, okay, let us see some variations here. Knight e7 check, rook captures, queen captures on e7. And now a into b2, threatening to capture the rook, also with a threat of queening the pawn. So say rook b1, and then c into d3, the e4 pawn is hanging, the c2 pawn is hanging, and it's gonna be little bit dangerous for white here. So instead of knight e7 check here, white first goes for b3, and now cd, and queen comes on c2 with the idea of if queen moves, then queen c2, this pawn, d3 pawn is hanging. So it looks like Magnus has successfully invaded on the queen side. And the idea is that white has a very good chance of winning, but the threat is if white fails to do that, it's gonna be losing for white. So that is the basic idea. However, Hikaru here goes for the absolute brilliant move h6 now, putting a lot of pressure on this g7 pawn. So g5 now, look, this dark squares of black is looking suddenly weak, and this knight is coming on e7, this queen is coming. Well, Carlsen's idea is that after knight e7 check, obviously king h8, bishop g5 is the correct move. Now bishop is coming on the f6 square, and is going to be a checkmate. So knight d7 now, defending the f6 square, and suppose queen into b5, then queen c3 check, king e2, and then c6 is coming. Queen into c6, queen into c6, knight into c6, and obviously white is here better with two extra pawns. And also two pawn islands, and it's gonna be very good for white. But however, the point is that after knight e7 check here, instead of king h8, black is gonna go for rook into e7, queen into e7 with the threat of queen f6 and g7 checkmate, but simply knight e6 defending the g7 square. And now it's gonna be very bad for white, because this queen is gonna be very active on the c3 square. So that is the basic idea of Carlsen. But instead of going for that, here white goes for rook c1. Idea is that now this rook is coming on the c7 square, and there will be two threats of g7 and f7 checkmate. Queen is coming on g7 or f7, it's gonna be a checkmate. So let us look at how this is gonna happen. So Magnus here goes for queen into d3. If knight e7 check, which is completely winning for Hikaru. If king h8, then obviously bishop is coming on g5 and f6, and it's gonna be a checkmate. And it's really hard for anyone to defend that, for black to defend that. But the idea is that if suppose rook captures, then queen into e7, queen into e4, picking up another pawn, because why not? Queen into f6 can be met with knight e6, defending the g7 square, but there is rook into c7 now. Now, obviously, if knight captures, rook, queen g7 is going to be a checkmate. And if black does not capture, then there is a threat of queen into f7. And that's going to be deadly. Queen into f7, king moves, and then queen is coming on h7. It's going to be a checkmate. So that is the basic idea. So knight into e7 is completely winning in this situation. However, Hikaru here goes for rook d1. With the idea of, okay, let's see what happens. Obviously, now this queen is under attack. So Carlsen needs to move his queen. So queen c2 by Carlsen, and Hikaru here goes for knight g7, trapping the rook. Now look, this d8 square is defended by the rook. These squares are defended by either the queen and the knight, and now it's looking, knight e7 could have been better, but this is not much worse. Carlsen here goes for bishop b7, putting pressure on the e4 pawn. So here white first captures the rook on e8, rook into e8, and then simply f3, defending the e4 pawn, also solidifying the position. Now white can simply go for attacking the king here. So however, Carlsen here goes for his last set of threats. So queen into a2 by black, now clearing the path for the pawn to be a queen. And any kind of miscalculation is gonna be dangerous and deadly for white. However, Hikaru here goes for rook d2, attacking the queen. Queen b1 check, now clearing the path. King f2 and a2 by black. Now this rook is coming on a8 and it's gonna be deadly for white. However, Hikaru here goes for queen c3, now defending the a1 square. Rook a8 now, and now Hikaru here goes for rook into b1. A into b1, queen. And now queen into e5 by white. The idea is that whatever here black does, it's gonna be a checkmate on the g7 square. And suppose black here goes for, say, knight e6, then bishop d4 is the move, and now there is a threat of queen h8 checkmate, and how it's gonna be saved by white. If knight into d4, then obviously queen into g7 is checkmate. If suppose a king f8, trying to save the king, then simply queen h8 check, king moves to e7, and bishop f6 is checkmate, and the position is completely lost. And suppose here after queen into e5, what else can be played? Say queen a1, someone in the audience was telling about this move. But then bishop d4, and now it's going to be a checkmate on the long diagonal. Obviously, if queen captures, then queen captures, white is ahead in material, and it's completely winning for white. And suppose here black goes for knight e6, then the threat is queen h8 is going to be checkmate, and it's completely losing for white. So it is on move 31. In this position, Magnus Carlsen resigned and Hikaru won the third game, equalizing in the last day of the finals of Magnus Carlsen Chess Tour. The game was a complete rush of blood, and the people who like aggressive chess, this game is just a game from the heaven of chess, and it's gonna be very exciting from them. However, with this, Hikaru managed to equalize the position, and also in the fourth game of the final day, they actually drew. The game went to Blitz and then Armageddon. Hikaru played an amazing game of chess and put a lot of pressure on the current world champion. However, Hikaru was completely winning in the Armageddon, but then Magnus amazingly made a fortress for his king and drew the game. And that is, I think, the power of a world champion, to deal with the time pressure, to deal with the excitement, and to deal with the adrenaline rush. So that is the quality of Magnus, to just convert anything into a win, at least to hold the position. That's why Magnus is famous for. However, the game in the Armageddon was a draw, but as Magnus was black, he won as per the rules of Armageddon, winning the tournament. But undoubtedly, Hikaru has shown his class, and he has shown that you have to be very much counter-attacking, not defensive, against to beat the world champion. So with this, we are coming to the end of the video. I am taking a leave. Probably I'm gonna come with some one or two games of Chess Olympiad that is going on of Indian players. So let's see what happens. But for now, I'm taking a leave. See you next time.